You're listening to the Spotless Podcast, where cleanliness is always next to podliness. Now, here are your hosts, Hannah Brooks Olson and Andrew Walsh.
Oh, it is a truly glorious day here in the Northwest. It is so beautiful. I just want to throw open all the windows and, use my seasonal scented all-purpose cleaner from Grove, because it is fully, fully spring here, at least where I am in Portland. Andrew, is it fully spring in Seattle yet?
It is stunningly spring here in Seattle. It's beautiful. We had my day started later today than it usually does, so I had time in the morning to take a morning walk around Green Lake.
Oh,
that
my
is
gosh.
Very unusual. And I want to say, you just set me up for this. You mentioned the home cleaning sense of springtime. I am trying out a new Mrs. Meyers scent in the spray bottle surface cleaner form. It is orange clove, I want to say. I was
that doesn't
very
sound that
nervous.
Springy.
Yeah, you're right. It's not actually a very springy smell. That is a bad transition. But you did mention smells.
New scents.
Yeah,
that's
sure,
true.
Whatever. I was very nervous about this one. Orange clove. I don't know. I like it, though. I like it a lot. It's nice to introduce new smells into your cleaning routine.
Yeah, I think a lot of times we think of new smells only as being involved in, like, holiday stuff. Like, I feel like, you know, you bust out the pine-scented candles, you have, you know, peppermint, whatever, like, in the fall and winter. But I do think it's nice to have also, you know, to incorporate smell into your cleaning as you move into a different season. And especially if you live in certainly the Northwest, but I think also, like, the Midwest, much of this country of ours, the transition from winter to spring is so, like, we all feel it on such a soul level. I feel like bringing scent into it is, like, always a good idea.
In fact, we'll tell you what's coming up on the show today in a little bit. We have so much to get to and not tons of time to do it, so I don't want to dilly-dally here, but this is right up our alley. Hannah, you wrote and released a newsletter on behalf of Spotless, I believe late last week, and it was all about something we talked about a bit last week, resting house smell, I think you called it, or potentially nose blindness.
Yeah, the resting house smell came from our listener
who
on our last show, and I love it.
And it's something that I'm super paranoid about. We already talked about that, but, you know, we have two cats here. I try to keep everything really clean, but if I go on vacation for a week or so and I come back, you can smell that cats live here. I wouldn't say it's an overwhelming smell of litter box. I would never let that happen. But to me, there's still an organic smell going on in this house that I don't love. And so I was really doing a lot of thinking about it. And I don't know if you would say this is just masking the problem, but I told Genevieve, I want to introduce a new olfactory profile in our house, and I want to do it.
I hope you said it exactly like that.
I think I did. Have we met? But it's true, because during the holiday season, Genevieve has one of those diffusers, I think we call it. It looks
sure.
I don't know, four incense sticks, but they're not incense sticks, and they're sticking out of a bottle of oil that has a, you know, whatever scent you choose. And we use that during the holidays to kind of maximize the pine scent of the holidays. But then it goes away for the rest of the year. And I want to bring one of those in for the rest of the year that is a different scent. And we are now in negotiations about what that scent should be. It seems like lavender might be some safe ground.
Interesting. See, because lavender is a no-go at my house.
Really? For both of you?
Not because of me, but because Keith does not enjoy the scent of lavender at all.
I was going to say why,
really curtailed my fragrance use.
It's really hard to say why, right? Because it's just a taste thing. But is there a reason why? Does he say it's too something?
I think it's too soapy, maybe. He is not. He is a person who tends to default to unscented things. Like, he uses unscented laundry soap. He doesn't really, like, have much need or care about fragrance, whereas I am obsessed with it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, I'll try out new candles and I'll ask him, like, well, what do you think about this? And he's always just kind of like, he doesn't really have like the language to describe it because I think it's just not something that takes up space in his brain. So the best I've been able to get on lavender is like soapy, I think.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. And also it is hard to describe why we like the certain tastes of things or the smell of things. What do you think of my idea, though? And be very honest with me. Like, what struck me about your newsletter was that you said try not to just cover up smells, get to the root of them. And some smells are just kind of baked into the wood of older places. You know, keep your walls clean and just make sure that you're not like kind of letting your carpets absorb bad smells because they'll live there forever. And you said don't just Febreze away. Do you think having a diffuser that lives in our main kind of living area, also the first room you walk into when you come into our apartment, do you think that's a masking agent or do you think that I could actually fundamentally change the olfactory profile?
I think you could actually make that change. And I think it wouldn't just be masking it because it's not like you have a bad smelling house and you're trying to like perfume over it. Like your issue is not one of smell. It's just one of like you have cats and there is always, and especially to you, there will always be like latent cat smell that mm-hmm. you will pick up on at any like little whiff. And so I don't think you are going to be trying to cover it. I think you're going to be trying to incorporate it into your existing house. And like houses, much like people, wear scents differently, right? So like you kind of have to bring a scent in and then see how it works with everything else in your house. And like my main conclusion is as long as you know you don't have like a black mold problem that is like eroding your lungs, I'm not that upset about people who want to kind of mask a scent. You know, if it's just something about the house or like old carpets that just smell, whatever. I think the concern is when you get into masking a scent instead of doing necessary hygienic cleaning, that's when it's a problem.
Yes. Now I'm going to, at the risk of expanding this conversation too much, I will say the one, I don't know if this is a sticking point, but one kind of point of quasi negotiation that's going on right now is, I said to Viv, you know, I want to get the kind that I just described before, this, you know, three or four sticks coming out of an essential oil bottle. And Genevieve said, those are nice. That's the kind we have for the holidays, but they're kind of expensive and you're locked in. And she's looking at some of these other diffusers that I think listeners have written in about before, too, that they come in all kinds of cute shapes, but you can buy little pods for them and alternate out smells from time to time. And I don't know if it's it almost looks in some of the illustrations like it's steam that comes out. I don't know if it's actually steam or they're just illustrating the smell.
Yeah, it like aerates. That's what it does. It like aerates. It's sort of like it's almost like a humidifier. But what it does is it disperses the oils. You can also look into the one we use in my house is wax melts. We're very into wax melts in my house.
With a candle? Underneath
Where you have like a tea light.
Yeah.
And so like, so that's the problem because it's not all the time. Like if you're trying to do something all the time, like the one with the sticks, I think is the thing that is the, you know, you're not using electricity. It's not plugged in. It just is a constant in your house. Whereas like the ones that you have to plug in, you have to have it plugged in. It might make a noise, you know. There's that to consider.
Well, that is exactly what I was going to say. I told Genevieve, I do not want to get anything else that I need to figure out how to plug it in, how to get it near a socket or a USB device to power it. Like I like the sticks the best. I like your candle solution. I'd forgotten about that, Hannah, but I do not want anything that has to be plugged in. Like that's my hard line in the sand on that.
Yeah,
I'm sick of plugging everything in all the time.
I mean, I just watched Keith do cable management this weekend. We got a new rug and he had to like put the cables all together under it. And it was,
God bless.
I mean, he did a great job. Bless him for doing it. I'm so appreciative that he does that element in our house. But he was just like, I swear to God, if I could have nothing plugged into anything ever, I would be so happy.
Yes. Yes. Me too, man. That is the platonic ideal. You know, this is the part of the show where usually I'd rattle off a whole bunch of things that are coming up. But you can tell I'm talking a mile a minute because we have tons of stuff to talk about. Just trust me. It's all good. I'm not going to waste time by telling you what's coming up in the next 45 minutes. You're just going to stick around because you're trusting my promise that this is going to be a kick-ass show. You agree with that, Hannah?
Yes. And we do. I mean, we have some really great stuff from our listeners, which is always fantastic. The more Andrew and I can sit around thinking about different ways to fragrance our homes and not think about how to actually make this show, the better.
Amen.
So bless you all for calling the spot line, which is 508-HOW-WASH, 508-469-9274. And that number will come back at the end of the show if you didn't catch it. So that's for people to call and leave us a voice message, which we adore. You can also find us on Twitter and Instagram, both at SpotlessPod, or you can send us an email, spotlesspod@gmail.com.
And you can find us, or at least you, in the Seattle Times this weekend, Hannah.
Yes,
your star is rising.
Finally, I got to give a blurb to the local newspaper about spring cleaning. That's all I've ever wanted.
There was, you and I are both embarrassed to take any kind of pleasure out of publicity, I feel like. But I'm happy a reporter for the Seattle Times reached out. She was doing a roundup of spring cleaning tips for this time of the year. And we had a pretty tight turnover time for it because I didn't notice her email for like 2 weeks. And you wrote a really, really nice thing. And you looked at it from a kind of behavioral point of view, as to not be intimidated by the spring cleaning ahead of you. And you led the column. You were the first expert, quote unquote expert, or just no quotes, just the first expert quoted.
I mean, I guess at the point at which we do this podcast, it's sort of like self-deciding I'm an expert.
Yeah, like, right.
But it was nice to be able to sort of kick it off and just be like, you know what? Don't look at your whole house and be like, wow, I hate this place. It's chaos. I'm going to burn it to the ground. Like, figure out where to start and do your little organizational chores. Do what you can.
I loved it. And also, I was talking to a friend this weekend who is applying for new jobs. And she was saying, she's significantly younger than me, and she was talking about how, she's got a job now. That's fine. And she likes it okay. And it pays the bills, but she really feels like there's something better out there for her. But it's just so hard at the end of the day to sit down after your long day of doing your other job, to sit down and, you know, start preparing a resume or all these things that I just find so onerous. And she said that her girlfriend was giving her the exact same advice that you were giving people about cleaning, which is just break it down one by one. Sit down. You don't have to do the whole thing. You don't have to apply for any jobs tonight. Maybe just sit down and look at one section of your resume tonight and just make that your goal. Chances are, once you're rolling on it, you'll want to keep rolling. But if you can break things down like that, they can be less intimidating.
I find that if a piece of advice works in cleaning, it tends to work in life.
Right.
And I know that that's like an extremely sweeping statement I just made. But it really is true. Like, a lot of my cleaning mentality sort of seeps into the rest of my life, because I feel the same way about like running. Like, I'm a runner, and I a lot of times will think like, okay, if I can just make it, you know, another half mile, then I'll be done. But then, much like with cleaning, once you hit that point, you're like, oh, well, I did that and I could keep going and I have time, so I'm just going to keep it up. So mm-hmm. I think that works on a couple of levels.
Before we get into the actual show today, I wanted to revisit something we talked about, I believe, 2 shows ago, so going on a month ago. We got an email and some photos from listener Kate, who she's a renter, and she has a radiator that is like wedged into this weird part of her bathroom.
It's like built into,
yes,
like between two walls.
Like, if you can imagine the foot of a bathtub, and then let's say there's about 3 feet between the foot of the bathtub and another wall. But then somebody says, I want to put an old style, big clanky metal radiator in there and then build a wall between the bathtub and the radiator. So it's like wedged back there. And first of all, it just seems like such a fire violation, such a fire code,
yes,
violation. Well, anyway, I'll tell you what, the reason I'm bringing it up now is because your mom called in. We haven't heard from Julie in a while, and she wanted to respond to that, as well as we must have made some comment about getting hoodies made that say Spotless. Hannah, do I not remember anything we ever talk about on this show?
No. If my mom, does this voicemail from my mom include an idea about merch?
Yes. She said,
okay,
why don't
no.
we all have hoodies?
I don't, one, because I don't think I've ever seen my mother wear a hoodie. And I don't think they make hoodies out of like black lace and gauze.
I'll bet they do. I'll find
literally
one.
What my mother, if you picture like what, like Morticia Adams, if she was like an older hippie living in Eugene, like that's what my mom wears.
Well, she's like she's like Wiccan chic, right? Is that right?
Yeah, yeah, like OG Wiccan chic.
Yeah.
If
she's got
it
a
looks
style,
like something,
I like that she's got a style.
oh, she has a style. My niece will tell you when something is, quote, just Nana's style. And it's usually when it looks like something that a Victorian baby could be buried in.
Let's not beat up on Julie.
No, this is all true. This is factual. None of this is a value judgment.
Okay, anyway. Well, Julie.
I think she's talking about merch because I had posted something on Instagram when I was staying at my sister's house for a couple of days. And my sister has one of the only existing Spotless merch items. Because like you had like a
freebie.
Yeah. Something like with your other podcast, whose name I don't speak. No, I'm kidding.
For TBTL, we had some, and I already don't even remember the name of the company, but it was one of those things where you can personalize anything, mugs, T-shirts, stickers, what have you. So I had some free tokens for that, so we made some sample Spotless stuff, which looks great using that little logo that you made.
Yeah, I think we literally made two.
Yeah, like two mugs, I think. Yeah.
Maybe three mugs. And one of them says not related to Hannah because the people who call into the show are overwhelmingly related to me. And the only person who has it is, in fact, my sister, one of the most related to me.
Yeah, ironically.
And I like to use that mug when I'm at her house. And so when I think that's why my mom was talking about merch. So should we listen to the voicemail?
Yeah, let's listen to it. Although I think I've spoiled almost everything at this point. But take it away, Jules.
Hi, Spotless Pod. Number one listener here. I'm sorry. Correction. Number one fan. I'm sure there are others who are also good listeners. The old envelope says, the back of the recycled envelope, item number one. Why don't we have Spotless hoodies? That seems like a thing we should have, mentioning Hannah hoodies. Let's have Spotless hoodies. Ask the listeners. I bet they'd buy them. You know I would. Lastly, the listener with the radiator.
All right, I think I can pause it there for a second. I just want to say, if we do get Spotless hoodies, we can give one to your mom. I don't think we should charge her, okay?
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Okay.
I think Julie can be our first like model, like yes, our hoodie model, yeah, and then yeah, she can keep the clothes. Yeah.
You're not paying for any Spotless swag. Do I say swag funny? Let's not get into
yes,
that.
Yes, you do.
I really do.
We
it's
don't
swag,
have
right?
Yes.
Why do I say swag? Swag is like bad weed that we used to buy in the 1990s. Is that right? Have you ever heard of swag? You think
wait,
I'm making this
I
up?
Get you. Just like it's one of those moments where someone says something, and something very far back in your memory is like, I recall. Yeah, I guess. Although that doesn't sound right either.
Like sometimes you'd get like, I mean, I wouldn't. Obviously, I was an altar boy, but one would get a bag of low grade marijuana with a lot of stems and seeds in it, and you would call it swag or the brown frown. Any of this ring any bells? No? I don't know. I just heard that from a guy. I don't know. I watch a lot of movies. All right, let's go back to your mom's voicemail.
Lastly, the listener with the radiator. Hannah's dad just about came off the couch because that shit ain't code, let me tell you. He worked with Hannah's grandfather for a million years, and they know about building code, and that is some sort of sad slumlord situation that poor listener has to deal with. I agree with Hannah. Get a hose and just spray it, because so what if it gets wet? It's a tile floor. And also, it's not up to code. So what you gonna do? Ruin it? No. Wash it, listener. Wash it with a hose. Love the show. Love you guys. Bye.
I didn't realize that she was echoing your recommendation, but I did like that. It's going to be a little bit messy if you bring a hose in there. So, you know, be prepared with a lot of towels, maybe even like kind of dam it up ahead of time if possible. But it is a bathroom and everything can get wet and then you can dry it off again. I also brought this up because I've had something nagging at me. So when Kate sent the original photos of this thing, they were very unflattering photos because they were extreme close-ups because she wanted us to see how kind of tough it is to get way back into the recesses of this thing. And, you know, she wanted to kind of point out how it can attract dirt back there. But she sent some follow-up photos of more of like the bigger picture of the bathroom. And I will say, I wouldn't want this radiator stuck back there, but when you see it in the context of the bathroom, it's nowhere near as bad as I thought it was before, and I almost feel bad for overreacting. She has, I I'm assuming this thing is not functional anymore, but she's has a
no,
little...
No, she says it is functional.
Oh, it is functional. Okay, but she's got
in
a little...
In the email that she sent...
Originally?
Because she sent a follow-up email. She said it is a functional radiator.
Oh, okay. Oh, yes, it is a working radiator. But I don't know if you saw the follow-up photos too, Hannah, but like it's cute. She's turned it into like a little shelf with a candle on there. It could definitely use a paint job, but I don't really know how you would paint it because eventually you'd get, you know, like... three rungs back and then your paintbrush wouldn't fit back there anymore. It would be really nice if it were temporarily removable. You could clean it and then give it a nice paint job. But I did just want to say that when you see it in the context of the bathroom, it's not ideal, but it's not slumlordy and it's not as bad as the close-ups made it seem.
Okay, I disagree because I'm looking. Okay, so these photos are on Instagram. You have to go back a little bit. But the one that's like a little bit further back where you can sort of see how it's situated, I just don't understand why you would put a wall there ever. It does not make sense. Like, I am so befuddled by how, what I have to assume is that there was a clawfoot tub or a standalone tub and a shower. And then when they took it out and they decided to put in a modern tub, like a floor tub and a shower, they had to put a back wall.
Mm-hmm.
And it appears that it's the back wall of the shower that abuts the radiator.
Right.
And that is a weird thing to do.
It is. I'm not
I don't know
saying-
if I'd say slumlord. I don't know what the deal is with your, you know, with your super there. But I do also, I don't see how this is up to code.
No, also. It can't be. And it also can't be efficient. All the heat's getting trapped back there. It's not going to flow. So again, I don't want to say that I'm defending the decision to do this. But there was one photo where I kind of saw, oh, I see it's in the back of the bathroom. You got these cute little like little wooden slat blinds on these windows next to it. It's a pretty cute bathroom with a flaw in it. But I think those close-ups, I just wanted to check my tone a little bit because I didn't want to make Kate feel terrible about this situation. When I saw what she's done with the space around it, I think she's definitely made lemonade out of lemons.
Yeah, using it as a little shelf is definitely a good idea. And I think, again, this is the kind of thing, and she said in her follow-up that also she is a renter. This is just the kind of thing that, like, as a renter, you just are perpetually dealing with, like, one weird fucking thing or another.
Mm-hmm, yep.
Like, oh, this refrigerator door is on the wrong side, or... like, why are all the outlets in one corner and nowhere else? Like, there's just all these things that when you rent, you're, like, at the behest of somebody and their other decisions, you know, well before you came along.
Yes. And a million bad decisions made along the way in between other renters and what have you. I mean, I could go on forever about the quirks in this place. But, well, I've already done that in every other podcast we've done. So let's just maybe start the show.
That ain't the cleaner. Head cares. Yes, yes, I'll polish the leaves, make them green again, shake out the trees, change the scene again, spring cleaning, getting ready for love.
Ah, that song is never more appropriate than it is on a beautiful spring day. Like today, I got a voicemail, Hannah.
Okay.
That could potentially change my life. Or.
I cannot wait.
I will completely ignore it. One of the two things
could happen here. If I was a betting man, if I was a betting man, I would put, you know, I'd put 50 on the ladder, but go on.
This is from listener Ebony, and she actually has 2 points she wants to make. Here's the first.
Hi, Hannah and Andrew. I am an OG listener from the very first podcast. My name is Ebony, and I love the show. I am calling to give, to ask a question and then also to give a tip. To Andrew, I was listening, I'm kind of behind in podcasts, but I was listening to the most recent podcast that I was listening to, and you talked about having a plastic shower curtain, and I've heard you talk about it many times before, and I don't understand why you don't get a fabric shower curtain. They're great. You can throw them in the washing machine and then put them back up, and they have fabric shower curtains and shower curtain liners. It is life-changing. It has been for me because every time it gets gross, I throw it in the washing machine. I get a plain white one so I can bleach it if I choose. And then it's good as new. I don't know if that's something you've considered before. If you have, just ignore the advice, but I think you might want to think about it as an option. And I doubt your cats will want to chew on the fabric one, but if they do, it's probably less annoying.
Now, I want to stop there for a second because I did talk to Genevieve about this. And I would say that I have always been leery of cloth shower curtains for several reasons. The first one is easily dismissed. I think that I don't like the aesthetic of it very much, of them very much. But that could be my very limited exposure to them, usually in like hotel bathrooms and what have you. I'm sure they come in all kinds of shapes and sizes. And if we went to a, you know, online realtor or any realtor that we trusted the kind of, you know, vibe of the place, I'm sure I could get something I really like. The part that is really tempting, of course, is that Theo will stop chewing on it,
right?
Hopefully, because it's driving me crazy. I mean, I think it's a anxiety thing that cats will sometimes do, chew on plastic. And he's like, you know, I'll clean the bathroom top to bottom, put up a new plastic shower curtain that has a design that I like that matches our bathroom. And then by the next day, he's already started chomping on the edges and making them all gross again, which I absolutely hate. But here's the thing about the shower curtain, the actual cloth with the plastic liner. You still have a plastic liner, as Ebony says. So even if it was a deterrent for Theo to eat it, I'd still have to be buying plastic liners for the other side of it, right? And I'm just wondering, like, all I'm doing is I'm adding one element. I'm not really taking away my plastic, you know, shower curtain. Or what am I not understanding about this?
Well, it sounds like she was saying that there are like washable shower liners as well. And so both the curtain and the liner could be something that you don't have to replace. So I think there might be, because right now you're only using basically a shower curtain, or you're using a combo curtain liner kind of thing.
Right now, I only buy plastic shower curtains. It's not a combo. It's just like, you know, you go to the drugstore. They're about $13, and you can get various designs on them. And we always have, there's one mass-produced one that we keep buying over and over, because it's got a subtle design that pulls out some of the other colors of our bathroom.
But it's like, it's basically a liner then.
It would be called a liner, only now they kind of just sell liners that can stand on their own with designs.
Right.
Yeah.
Which, now that's what I always had. My family did not, we certainly were not fancy enough to ever have a curtain. And never in my life did I have both a shower and a liner until I moved in with a former partner, and his family was like very, like, his family's from the South. They have ways of doing things, and that's how you do them. And so things like a curtain and a liner, like, when he had both of those things, I didn't know what to make of it. Because I was always just, like, plastic, liner, whatever, has a map of the earth or fish on it or some
right, you know.
And then you just have a shower curtain, and that's it. And it's just one thing. So even having two was very strange to me. I'll have one of each, and what I get is, instead of getting like I spend like a tiny bit more, but I get a liner that is either made of recycled plastic or it is made of like some other kind of material. And like, the point of a shower curtain and liner is just to keep water from winding up everywhere in your bathroom, right? Like, that is the point. Also to keep some of the like warmth in, so you're not like freezing in an exposed shower. So like, once you have that need met, it's sort of an issue of like extrapolating from there what else you need. I think if you had a cloth curtain, it might be somewhat of a deterrent to keep Theo out away from a plastic shower liner, because he'd have to get to it. So that's kind of challenging. And if you found one that you liked from a visual standpoint, you know, you could wash it. I also find that your shower curtain gets less, like the, or your shower liner, the plastic bit, gets less gross when it's working in tandem with a curtain. But that could just be like confirmation bias.
Yeah, I will say, because I am so fastidious about the shower curtain, and because Theo keeps chewing them up, that we luckily have not been having gross shower curtains. Now, we've been filling the landfill with a lot of old shower curtains, so that's not great. But luckily for me, We're always buying ones that have a pretty light or clear pattern to them, so it's not adding a bunch of darkness to the tub. I do find that, like, you know, if there's a lot of darkness with the dampness, that's where you're going to start to get mold and those mildewy things growing faster. So luckily, ours has not been, like accumulating the pink slime or any of that kind of stuff. But it is pretty – I think once Theo starts chomping on it, it gets pretty nasty. But anyway, I'm going to do some poking around. I mentioned this to Genevieve. I said cloth shower curtain. This is right after our olfactory profile conversation, and she kind of made the look where I thought she was going to say hard no, like I'm a hard no on a fabric shower curtain, but then she kind of softened on that a little bit. So she and I are just, we're in a lot of talks right now. We're just kind of exploring where we are.
I can tell you that I literally just Googled washable shower curtain liner, and I got like a wire cutter article from the New York Times reviewing the best shower curtains. Business Insider had the best shower curtain liner in 2021. So you've got reading to do.
Yeah, I got a lot of research to do. All right, now, Abney goes on to talk about something totally different that I think about all the time in the context of Spotless, and I'm so glad she brings it up.
And then the other thing I wanted to ask is if you have ever considered doing an episode topic around digital cleaning. I mean, it's not really cleaning. It's more like organizing and minimalism, but you guys have kind of, your mission statement has expanded to home economics, so maybe it can expand to this. But I have a million files, and I don't know what to do with them. I have pictures, I have just downloads and everything else, and I don't know what to do with it. And every time I look at my desktop, I know that I need to get rid of some of these things because my hard drive is almost clogged, and it's just a pain. And I don't know if there's a simple, easy way to do it. If you have any advice or if any of the other listeners have advice, I would love to hear it. All right. Thank you for a great show. Bye-bye.
I think about this all the time, and you will not be surprised to know that I have all kinds of incredibly tedious rituals based around this because...
Well, I have watched you name files before. So I can imagine.
Yeah, no, every file I have begins with the date, the year. So like today's show, when we're done with today's show, I'll move it over to my desktop and I will call it 20210412, right? That way I always am starting with the date. And if you have a bunch of files in a folder together, you can always sort them easily by the date. I mean, that's just the beginning. And also, I don't even know where to begin with this because I feel like, as Ebony says, it could be a full show. The most important thing, I think, just to echo exactly what we started this show talking about, Hannah, is like I will start to feel overwhelmed sometimes by the files accumulating. Like I get a bunch of obviously I record this podcast. I record a bunch of podcasts in my life, right? One for work, and that's a daily podcast. And so those things pile up, and I have a very meticulous way of saving them, but eventually they have to be moved off of my computer. So I have hard drives that I move them onto, and then I back them up because that stuff is, if I lose my original files, I'd be in a lot of trouble. And I have processes built into that, but to go back to what we were talking about at the beginning of the show, I'm getting the impression that Abney feels a little overwhelmed by this. Like, it's been piling up. It sounds like her desktop is a disaster, no offense, you know, and she doesn't even know where to begin. And so I would definitely say, behaviorally speaking, again, maybe take small bites at this apple, figure out what you want to do. I will just dazzle you with one story, Hannah, of how I was feeling overwhelmed. And I don't think that I'm much help here because I am, this is where, and I try not to use the word like OCD because I know that that's a real medical diagnosis and I don't think I've been diagnosed with it. But I definitely have some tendencies, right? And one thing that I noticed started happening a couple of years ago is I have, not to brag, but a phone built into my camera, or I should say a camera built into my phone. That would have been funnier if I had gotten the joke right. Yeah, I know. And my phone, you know, at some point I bought it and it was automatically, I told it to go ahead and connect itself to my Dropbox account so that as I take photos on my phone, they automatically get uploaded to Dropbox, which is great because if the phone breaks or whatever, you always have this archive. But I don't pay for Dropbox. I have a very limited account, and for some reason, I'll pay for all kinds of crap, but for some reason, I got it in my craw that I'm not going to pay for Dropbox. I'll just keep it clean, right? So this thing started filling up, and then things weren't backing up anymore, and I didn't know what to do, and I kind of got a little bit to that point that Abney is describing, where you're just kind of like, I don't know. I need to sit down. It's going to take me forever to figure out a system. Well, eventually, my system was this. About once, maybe twice a year, I go into Dropbox and I download like 6 months worth of the photos. You can kind of download them in zip files and you can save them however you want. Obviously, I do it very meticulously and by date. And so I download them all. I clear out my Dropbox. I have them on my hard drive. Then I buy solid state external hard drives. I do suggest solid state if anybody is researching the kind of hard drives to get externally. Solid state are more likely to last the long haul. They don't have any moving disks or anything in them, which is why things eventually end up crashing and you lose your precious memories. But I will download them all from Dropbox, move them over to my external hard drive, and then I'm going to say going back about 5 years now, I always have two big folders per year. One that says Andrew camera photos. Those are photos that I've taken with my digital camera. And Andrew phone photos. And then when you open up those folders inside, you will find month-by-month breakdowns of all of my folders. It does take a little bit of time to set that up. And if you're not somebody who has my, tendencies, that might sound just awful to you. But I find it to be such a zen-like feeling as I'm doing it. You feel like you're really getting something done without really having to exert much energy.
Right.
And you're really clearing the plate when all of those things are safe and secured and nicely labeled and they're on your solid state drive and you have 17 billion gigabytes of space free again on Dropbox. It is a delicious feeling.
I am a mess digitally. So I once had an external hard drive that had all of my photos and all of my like everything from college and it died. And so then I became scorched earth with saving anything because I was like, well, never mind. Nothing is permanent. All my memories are gone. Whatever. And so then I just stopped giving a shit. And now my Google Drive is a mess. My Dropbox is a mess. And I just, and it's one of those things that I would like to maybe deal with it at some point, but it's never a priority. I think we should definitely have this be, I would love to do this as an entire topic.
Yeah.
And I would love to hear what listeners, like, how do you take care of your digital files? I feel like it's this non-existent, but extremely, extremely existent issue that is very modern. I guess even 20, 30 years ago, people had their paper files, they had filing cabinets, they had their documents literally stored and you could kind of see them and go through them. Digitally, I feel like there's way more places for stuff to hide and there's way more ways to like misplace your files. So I would love to do more on this subject.
Yeah, we should. And of course, when you talk about photos, like my grandma, I remember her pulling down big boxes of photos going back 50, 60 years, you know, and she wasn't obsessed with organizing them. In fact, I think some of the fun of going through those boxes was the randomness of it. You know, you might find something from last Easter next to a photo of great grandpa from 1914 or what right. have you. And there is something random and beautiful about that. What I described with my digital photos now, especially the ones on my phone, because so much, like, how many photos do you think I have on my phone are just photos of what garage level I parked on any given day in Los Angeles? Or the whiteboard. I used to take a photo. We'd have our show meeting for a talk show I worked on. We'd have our show meeting, plan everything out on the whiteboard. And then I would take a photo of that whiteboard after every meeting so I could take it back to my desk and start working on things. And so I have like a year and a half of photos that like every single day I have a photo of this whiteboard that still when I stumble on one of those photos, it gives me a sense of dread because I hated that job so much. And I'm like, I see those and I feel the anxiety coming off of the expo markers or the expo erasers.
No, you gotta delete those. If they're not like, and not to go all, you know, Marie Kondo on you, but if looking at them doesn't make you think like, oh, remember when I did this thing? Like, if it's like the bad nostalgia, the brown frown of nostalgia, if you will, like, you got to just delete them. Don't even, like, they don't need to take up space in your digital life.
But the thing is, it would be so much more work to, like, hunt and peck those out and delete them. I mean, that's kind of what I'm saying here. And with my phone photos, I like them. One thing I want to say here at the top is not only do I have this, you know, this tendency to want everything to be in its place, I also really feel like in another life I would have loved to be an archivist, like an honest to God archivist of some kind.
Yes.
I was just going, I have a box full of like antiquated technology, and I just did a video for my other job about it. Like, I have just like all kinds of like recorders and devices and media formats going back years and years and years and years. And one of the things I have is a bag full of mini cassettes, the kind that are just like, you know, the size of your thumb, but they were actual cassettes that we would put in our answering machines. And there was a period of about 2 years in college when I realized, you know, I don't keep a regular journal, but what is an amazing journal would be if I kept all of these, just these voicemails that people were leaving me, these answering machine messages. So I started, instead of re-recording over top of them, I would just collect them. I would put a date on them. I would actually log what was on the tape, like, you know, March 14th, 1999, message from Paul. You know, March 14th, and I probably even timestamped them too. I mean, this is how my brain works, which is not normal and probably not great. And I still have those tapes. I don't know where the logs are, unfortunately, but someday I'm going to digitize them, and it's going to be like a real time machine for me. More than carefully taking a photo or carefully writing in a log, I think there's something about the ephemera of answering machine tapes back in the day when we left messages for people that will actually be a better window on my life than something that I deliberately tried to make as a memory, if that makes sense.
Well, certainly. And I think especially like just because you're a person who works in audio and you always have.
Yeah,
like,
right.
Those, you know, those are just, and also like, I mean, of all the, like, whenever I, you know, watch or listen to like a true crime or a historical podcast or a documentary or whatever, the thing that I always love the most is when you get to hear people in their element, in their everyday life, in their, you know, in their own voice. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the kind of tape that is, that's very valuable. So that's something you, yeah.
Exactly.
Backing up and saving.
Yeah, and someday I will do that. And I love the idea that, you know, I have voicemails from my grandma who's been long gone on there. But anyway, I was kind of using that as an analogy. It's top of mind for me, but also I'm using that as an analogy to think about how we treat our photos that are on our phones. Because like I am a bit of a, like, an amateur photographer. I have a camera that I love that I go out and I take photos that I frame up nicely and I try, you know, share them on social media or do whatever. It's my hobby. But then my phone is so much different. It's more like those answering machine tapes. Like I say, maybe it's a photo of the whiteboard that gives me a little sense of dread. Maybe it's a, hey, I parked on level 4B. This is where your car is. But then also there might be, you know, just photos of friends or whatever. And I like that it's all mixed up. I love that I can both save them by date because they are digital. So I can go back to a very specific year. But then I can click through these things that are not super curated and not super beautiful, but just like real slices of my life. And I don't do that a lot, but when I am in that mood, I can easily go back to that stuff. And it makes me feel good knowing that I have years and years and years of memories on something the size of a deck of playing cards that is pretty accessible.
How many hard drives do you think you have?
Well, that's an interesting question. Unfortunately, that technology is kind of changing too. Like, I have an old hard drive that needs to be plugged in, and it's about the size of I have this one hard drive. My first external hard drive is the size of your computer, probably. It's like a shark fin type of thing.
Oh my God.
No, it's probably the size of like your router, maybe. I don't know, but it's like, and it has to be powered up, and like, that, I don't know what's on there because that thing is probably 20 years now. But then they have these sleeker ones now, and I can't emphasize enough, if somebody is really trying to store something that is of value, get a solid state drive. They're more expensive, but they're believed to be able to withstand way more than those other drives like yours that crashed on you. But I'm also, I got like ones that are specific for TBTL, and then I have bought some that I want to back up those backups in case there is a, you know, catastrophic fire or something like that at my place. I want to make sure that Luke has other backups of it, because if we lose that stuff, we really lose it, you know. So
right.
I don't know, to answer your question, probably too many. Okay, so maybe we can revisit that at another time, because
yes.
I realize I've spent way too much time on that. Can we get one more interesting? We're leaving so much on the table, and this is my fault, but I really want to hear from Caroline here. We'll listen to her voicemail, and then we will describe the photos that she sent us.
Hi, Andrew. It's listener Caroline in Toronto. I have a question about how to clean my air conditioning unit. So at my house, there is a large outdoor air conditioning unit that is just covered in dust and dirt. And I don't know if I can use water, if I can take the cover off, how to get in there, like if I go in with a spray, spray from the inside to knock it off the outside, or if I wipe it down. I don't want to damage all the little metal coils. So I was wondering if maybe you guys have any suggestions, or if any of the listeners have any suggestions. And I'm going to email you a couple of photos as well, because maybe that will help guide the advice. Thank you so much. Looking forward to hearing what you come up with. Bye.
Hannah, I'm going to let you describe these photos. I just want to emphasize here, this is one of those large outdoor, sits-on-the-ground air conditioning units that, you know, probably cools the entire building it's attached to. It's not like a window unit or anything like that.
Yeah, it's like the big outside one that's sort of like rounded on the edges. It is, I can't, it's hard to tell sort of from what we're provided with here, but these things can be pretty big, and it is extremely gross on the inside, like in between the little like cage sort of thing that protects the inner workings. There's just a fuzz coating the whole thing.
Because these units, and I'm no expert, but you get the impression from looking at this that it's sucking in air from the outside and then processing it and cooling it and then pumping it into your house. And because it's sucking in air, what we're seeing is basically the outside of a filter, that all of the particles and dust and feathers and everything that accumulates outside is being pulled into this thing and then stopped by just on the other side of this grate. And it's like you said, a full wall of lint that is probably like, you know, a half an inch or an inch thick. Who knows? Now,
yeah, it's a full on blanket of lint and like pollen and, yeah, like you said, feathers.
Now, I think, and I could be wrong, and I don't know what Caroline's situation is. If she's, I assume that she's a homeowner and owns this unit. I think I see some like pretty exposed nuts and bolts on this thing. I think it's relatively easy to pop that grate off. And because there's a grate between this wall of lint, which is going to make it hard to get to, I think you could probably relatively easily, if you make it your project on a Saturday, pop that thing off and first of all expose all of that, and then I want to take a broom, or at least a whisk broom, but I think just a broom, a straight handle broom, and start by pushing that stuff down and away, and just, I think you're just, that's going to take care of let's say 75% of it.
I know, I'm unsure of if this grate's going to come off. I'm looking at like the kind of like bolts that are on it. They're kind of big. I do wonder, so I don't know. I don't know anything about air conditioning at all, in part because I'm from the Pacific Northwest and we don't do that here. Literally have never lived in a place with actual air conditioning where you can make it colder. Like, I have always been at the mercy of, you know, shutting the windows in the morning. So I don't know very much about it, but what I do know is that there's a lot of people who do know a lot about it, and I'm wondering if this is something like an HVAC specialist could help you with.
I think certainly. I mean, that was my first thing, is if it's not too expensive, I feel like there are services that would come out and, well, I guess service your HVAC stuff like this. And if you just said, hey, it needs a yearly cleaning, and I mean, I don't know how much that costs, though. If this were me, and I truly owned it, and it wasn't like, you know, whatever.
You weren't like a renter.
A renter. For some reason, I was like, if I was living with my parents or something, which is just a weird thing to say. I don't think I'll be living with my parents anytime soon. But point is, if my dad said to me, hey, help me with this, I'm not saying that I would take a wrench and just go start taking things apart without permission. But if it were truly mine, I guess I'm comfortable enough. I'm looking at like four of the bolts that are very specific to the grate thing. And I'm thinking I'd at least give that a day in court at first. Like take one out and just see what happens and see if I get too
nervous.
Would
you? Oh,
yeah,
okay.
Absolutely. But again, this isn't mine. And if Caroline isn't comfortable with that, no problem. I mean, also, Hannah, I do think the best advice is probably call a professional. And while we are experts, we're not professionals. I also wonder if you used a broom, could you even knock some of that shit away without taking the grating off?
Well, I was wondering about that, too. Is there a way to either maybe... you wouldn't want to go at it with, like, canned air because that's not going to be enough. This yeah. unit appears to be as tall as I am. Mm. But if there's a way, too, to sort of spray air... I'm imagining like standing outside with like a like a Victorian bellows.
yes.
But like, you know, to sort of, yeah, blow some air in there and just break up this blanket. Because I also feel like this has to be impeding the function of your AC unit. Right. Like
mm-hmm.
this can't be good for its function.
It feels that way to me. Yeah.
And so I think, yeah, if you could try and just like knock some of it down, it would be beneficial, but it will be difficult to do without removing the little cage thing. So it's interesting because I mean, you know me, we've often joked that I'm like the person who's up late at night trying to figure out how to fix my vacuum cleaner. Like I love to tinker. I love to take stuff apart, much to Keith's chagrin, mm-hmm. because he will always be like, oh, like this thing, something's wrong with it. I don't know what to do. And I'll be like, I can fix it. And mm-hmm. he's like, you can only fix it a third of the time. But that's a third of the time isn't bad.
Yeah.
Having exactly zero like knowledge of how to do anything handy at all. But for this, there's something about like an AC unit and like HVAC where I'm just like, I don't know, like that is really a black box to me. I might hire someone. However, if I did hire someone to clean it, I would also require that they let me watch and yes. ask them annoying questions while they did it.
Yeah,
because
it looks so satisfying, doesn't it?
Yeah, I need to be part of that.
I should have done more of this before the show, but I'm sort of just Googling on the fly here, and I would recommend that Caroline and anybody else who's interested in this do a little bit of Googling. I mean, I don't want this show to be like people ask us questions and I tell you to Google it, but one of her questions specifically was, can I hose it down? And I'm seeing in several places that it does say, yes, don't be afraid of hosing it down and don't even worry about using high pressure, not like a special
hose,
but high pressure on your garden hose. In fact, I'm looking at something here. This is a servicechampions.net. There are specific things you can get to, you know, clean this out properly, but doing a quick scan here, they do recommend turn off the unit by going inside and, you know, turning the thermostat to off. If possible, kill the switch that powers the unit, you know, using your breaker
sure.
box or whatever. Those would be some good safety measures. And then, yeah, you can hose spray to clean off the debris on the outside of the unit and wait 10 or 15 minutes. There's some cleaner solutions they're suggesting that I'm not going to get into here. But anyway, it doesn't sound like you need to be too afraid of exposing this to water. It is something that is outside and exposed to the elements at all
sure.
time. So
that anyway. Makes sense. Well, yeah. Okay. So maybe just go at it with, you know, with your garden hose and just see how much you can, you know, free up.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
And take a before and after photo for us.
Yes.
Please.
Well, I guess we have the befores. I'm dying to see the afters. I mean, what I want to be is what I want is to shrink myself down to about 2 feet, maybe a foot and a half, and have a, forced air thing, and I want to be inside the unit power spraying air out, if that makes sense, you know, because this has been
yes.
collecting all this stuff because it's sucking it in. I want to be on the other side of this wall of lint with like a Ghostbuster pack on, only it's full of forced air and blowing it out. But I think that might not be a practical solution.
I love that you're like, what would you do if someone shrunk you fantasy is you're like, I would clean small spaces.
Yeah. Ant-Man could have been such a better movie. That's all I'm saying.
I'm just imagining, like, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
Right.
Except it's Honey, I Shrunk the Kids to make them do household chores.
Honey, I cleaned the HVAC. All right, we got to get out of here. We are, again, leaving a lot on the table. That is because I am a motor mouth about hard drives, and because you guys have been leaving us so much good stuff. And also, we have some, Hannah, quick forward promo for next week's show. You haven't heard this yet, I don't think. Let's just say we'll be getting into the topic of shower worms. How do you feel about that? Shower worms, Hannah.
What? Like ringworm?
I don't know what the hell these things are, but a listener needs our help. I can't wait to talk about that next week. Plus, a lot of other stuff that we've left. Oh, and I'm sorry. How are you doing with your blinds? You asked the listeners for help washing your window blinds.
I did, and one of the listeners I saw suggested steam, like a steamer.
Yeah.
And that's really honestly what I think is going to – I think that's probably what it's going to come down to. I think I'm going to go rent like an actual steamer. I don't know how it's going to go yet, but it's – again, it's walking that line too as a renter where it's like I don't necessarily have to do this.
Mm-hmm.
It's – you know, they rented this place to us with like food on the blinds, but I just don't like looking at it.
Mm-hmm,
and so
yeah.
To me, it's like worth it to just be like – I think I just might end up steaming them.
It's interesting, though. You don't think that your little steamer vacuum is the right tool. You're going to rent something that is more appropriate for this particular task.
Yeah, because I think what I need is like a clothing steamer. Like, that's what I was picturing. Like, you know, the kind you can use in a hotel.
Sure.
That where it like applies the steam to sort of get crud off. I think that's what has to happen.
All right. Interesting. Thanks for the suggestions on that. Everybody else, take a listen to the old-timey radio guy. He's going to tell you how to get at us. And Hannah, I don't want to necessarily have the last word. I will give it to you. And if you don't have a last word, I've made things very awkward.
I do have a last word. I want to hear people's ideas about digital cleaning. I'm going to put something on Instagram about it, just like asking, is this something you think about? And I would love to hear your insights. Also, there's been a very interesting conversation happening on Twitter about which shows you can putter to.
Oh.
And yeah. And I recently had an experience where I was really enjoying a show I was watching, but I had to turn it off and put on something else because it was too imperative that I watch it visually, so I couldn't clean at the same time.
Uh-huh. Perfect.
So, if you want to weigh in about which shows you putter to, definitely Twitter's the place to do that.
Awesome. Too much good stuff. Just like Tumgus. Too much good stuff. We'll talk to you guys in a couple of weeks.
Listening to the Spotless Podcast. If you have a question for Hannah and Andrew or some cleaning advice, call the Spotline at 508-HOW-WASH. That's 508-469-9274. You can also email them at spotlesspod@gmail.com. We'll be back soon. But until then, always remember, life is messy, but it doesn't have to be.